HS2 is expensive. I imagine that's something you never thought you'd hear me say, but it is undeniable. Does that mean I think we should cancel HS2? The answer is still an emphatic no. But we do desperately need to learn lessons to bring the cost of construction within the UK down.
If you can put to one side suggestions that HS2 will cost over £100 billion, or if you're an opponent of HS2, resist the urge to comment white elephant, then I'll do my best to explain how we got here. I still doubt that I'll convince opponents that HS2 is worthwhile, but I think just saying HS2 in isolation is expensive is not helpful, and HS2 is certainly not the most expensive project in kilometre terms for those who like to use that most basic of metric. It's important to start by saying that I do not feel that HS2 is needlessly expensive, as difficult as that may be to believe. But the fact is, building infrastructure in the UK is expensive, especially when compared to less densely populated countries such as France and Spain.
But what has this got to do with a disused railway, which I'm currently exploring in the style of Paul Whitewick?
Well, much of the cost is down to just how densely populated the UK is, which means there is infrastructure everywhere, and that means HS2 has to build bridges. In fact, 500 bridges between London, Birmingham and Handsacre alone. If you consider that a straightforward road bridge can cost anywhere from £15 to £30 million, then you can hopefully start to see the scale of the challenge, and why, even without talking about mitigation, the cost can quickly escalate.
Unlike the early railway pioneers, who often built the smallest structures they could get away with, like this modest road over rail bridge behind me,
HS2 has to design bridges to meet certain modern standards, such as if a bridge is crossing above a main road, then the bridge must be built high enough to accommodate HGVs, which are just under 5 metres tall,
which require much more significant earthworks and much more material than this bridge.
Even relatively modern bridges built in the 20th century, which were designed with road vehicles in mind, fall short of today's standards. So that's problem A, having to build a large number of bridges crossing everything from existing railways and canals to motorways and major A roads which didn't even exist 60 or 70 years ago. The 220km route also requires the construction of 50 significant viaducts, some of which, if built alone, would be an impressive undertaking, such as the 3.4km long Conn Valley Viaduct. Then there's the fact that around 30% of the route is either in a deep cutting, tunnel or green tunnel. This leads us arguably to one of the biggest reasons the line costs so much, compared to similar lines around the world. That being the sheer amount of mitigation that has been designed into the route just to get it through the planning phase. Some tunnels are necessary, such as those under central London, but others, such as the 16km long Chiltern Tunnel, were added to mitigate the impact of the line. I'm not going to debate whether or not all of the mitigation measures should have been constructed, but they certainly added to the cost. Then we get onto the much talked about BAT mitigation structure, which reportedly cost £100 million, a staggering amount to protect bats, so say HS2 detractors, who would like to use this as an example of over-engineering, which is solely the preserve of HS2. But if you consider that HS2 has legal obligations to protect wildlife, and that the DfT stipulated that structures must last 120 years without the need for significant maintenance, then you should start to be able to see the issue. I often feel that HS2 opponents envisage contractors rubbing their hands together thinking, right, let's build the most expensive structure possible. But it's just not like that. Contractors building HS2 simply have to comply with planning regulations and wildlife protection laws, whilst designing structures to specifications set by the DfT. All whilst trying to appease hostile local authorities, such as Buckinghamshire County Council, who seemingly wants to make everyone's lives harder, rather than working with HS2 to find the best compromises.
Just while I've got your attention, I'd like to say a big thank you to my YouTube and Patreon supporters who helped make videos like this possible. your ongoing support really is appreciated, so thank you. If you'd like to add your name to the list, then there'll be links in the description below.
Some may argue that a 120-year lifespan is just another example of HS2 gold plating. But I would say, why shouldn't we leave a lasting legacy for generations to come, rather than building the minimum viable product which will need ongoing maintenance mere decades after opening? Speaking of the gold plating accusation, it is often said that HS2 is expensive because of the speed, and that a 240 or 300 km per hour railway would be significantly cheaper. But most experts seem to agree that reducing the speed would only reduce the cost by around 10%. But reducing the speed would reduce the benefits by a greater extent, which would ultimately negate the savings. The simple fact is, no matter what speed the trains are going, the land still needs to be purchased, and the 500 bridges still have to be constructed. In fact, if HS2 followed the M40 using a slower alignment, as some have suggested, then even more bridges would be required, further adding to the cost. And even if the line was to accommodate slower trains, then I very much doubt there would be any less opposition. Then we get to the protracted planning system in this country, with HS2 taking over 10 years to get from the concept stage to construction, with thousands of people working for much of that time just to set out the basic design of the route and get HS2 through the hybrid build process. If you consider design work which cost over £100 million was written off after the government changed its mind about Euston, then it's easy to imagine a figure heading into the billions of pounds just to plan and design HS2 Phase 1. All of this is not to say that I think it's acceptable that building infrastructure in the UK is so expensive, be it roads or railways, but people have the perception that the cost problem only applies to HS2. However, HS2 simply steals the spotlight because of its size. The sheer scale has simply amplified a problem which the UK seems to have been struggling with for decades. I don't think releasing an early lowball estimate for the cost of HS2 was helpful either, as even with an optimism bias applied, trying to come up with an early estimate without fully understanding what you have to build will provide a very optimistic result, which in turn provides headlines such as the cost of HS2 has risen from £36 billion to £100 billion. The £100 billion cost claim has become so ingrained in the debate, it's probably not worth trying to challenge the claim at this point. But I do feel I should add, the current cost projection ranges from £66 billion to £74 billion, with around £30 billion already having been spent. A staggering amount, I admit, but I just wish the media especially would be a little more accurate when reporting the cost.
Whilst I can't offer any solutions today, I do think the planning system needs to be overhauled, and the government needs to commit to projects rather than changing the spec halfway through or cancelling large sections like they did for HS2. This sort of government interference can create ripples of uncertainty throughout the construction industry, making companies think twice about bidding for work or investing in the skills and equipment required to build the infrastructure that this country desperately needs.